backstage with yoga pants and flip-flops. And it feels really awesome. And as I look around, I feel overdressed. So good. Does anybody else in here smell like smoke? I feel like, I keep thinking, boy, everywhere I am, I feel like I stink just from being in here, from walking around outside. But anyway, I'm so grateful for this event, and I wanna start with that. And I wanna reiterate and thank Jeff and Angela and Steve and everybody else who worked so hard to put this on. This has been an amazing event for me. I didn't attend what was going on today because I was dealing with family things and hurricane things, and it's so amazing. I wanna thank you for the prayers yesterday. All I know is we did it, and the storm is reducing, and it went from a 5 to a 3, and it's coming up high. And it's still bad, but it's not near as bad as it was yesterday morning when we started. And I called my sister to check on her today, and my husband is staying there. And I'm thanking her. I'm saying thank you so much for having Phil there and my brother so that I feel good to come here and I know he's taken care of. You know, and you know what she said? She said, Lynn, thank you for the generator, for the plywood, for the gas, for the food, and for everything that you always do for our family. Thank you. And I was like, thank you, Arantz. And feeling really proud of myself for the choices that I made in my life to make a change so that I am able to do what I just did or what I can do for my family and others, because that's what all this is about. It is about a choice that we decide we're going to do something different in our life because we want more. So I just want to say I'm grateful to all of you. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for helping me to move the storm, for helping keep it off our coast, and pray for everybody on the West Coast that, you know, this just breaks apart more, and we'll just be grateful and get it through so we can get on with what we're doing. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you to everybody here. And also thank you to the amazing presenters yesterday. Because as I was listening, and it was so amazing to me, because we all build our business differently. It's so amazing, and yet we all do the same thing. And so I was taking pages and pages and pages of notes yesterday from all the speakers who were up there, and I was getting little tidbits and saying, oh, that's good, that's good, that's good. And we're all sharing, and what it came down to is, you know, there's different ways, there's different styles. When I was listening to, I can't remember everybody's name, but, you know, people are saying the smart links. Smart links work and the YouTube things, and I'm thinking, I don't know how to work the smart link. I don't even know how to find YouTube. You know, that's not what I do, but I still get it done in the way that I do. And it made me realize the similarities that all of the leaders have is that we want it, we committed to it, failure is not an option. We worked our butts off, all of us, to get where we are. And, you know, when I'm standing up here, a lot of times people say, you know, well, Steve, or any of the leaders that are up there, or Lynn, you know, we can't do it, you know, because we don't have what you have, and, you know, and they think that I started out like this. And so I want to start my talk this afternoon by just sharing a little bit of my story and where I came from and what an event meant to me. Because an event is what changed my life and brought me to the place that I'm standing up here as a founder in RX. So I'm going to take you back to when I started, because this is really important to me that you understand, you know, that everybody who doesn't know me here knows where I came from. It was 1997. I was 50 years old. I was dead broke. I was working a full-time job in a marble tile and granite store. I didn't have a dime in the bank, and I was living in an apartment in Central Florida. I was a single mom. I raised 2 children, and for the majority of their childhood, they were on food stamps. They lived on food stamps. They spent their childhood in daycare. They grew up eating macaroni and cheese, Chef Boyardee, hot dogs, and SpaghettiOs, you know, and somehow I thought I was feeding them healthy. That's why I've struggled my whole life, because I thought that was a healthy meal until about 20 years ago when I started learning about nutrition. So I started with nothing. And all of a sudden, I'm 50 years old and I start thinking about what does somebody like me do? You know, if I ever want to retire or want a better life, because I wanted a better life. My grandkids were playing softball, you know, or baseball, and I couldn't go because I had to work. And it was killing me that what was in my heart that I wanted so badly in my life, what was most important to me, I couldn't do it because I was tied down to a job and I was broke. So I'm introduced to my first network marketing company by my daughter. I didn't know anything about network marketing, nothing, other than the horrible things that I'd heard about it, you know, that it was a really bad thing to do. But it came to me right through the back door. I was sick, I was having all kinds of health challenges. All of a sudden I get some vitamins in the mail, I'm taking some products, my daughter says, how you feeling? I'm like, I'm great. Well, Mom, you know, you can get these wholesale if you decide you just want to sign up. And I said, sign up for what? And she said, well, it's this company. And I said, is it one of those pyramid things? And she said, well, it is, but you don't have to do that part. But I know you, and you're a caretaker and a caregiver, and if you like something, you're going to open your mouth and you're going to tell everybody anyway. So if you don't want to do it, fine, but you can buy wholesale since you like the products. Just give me your credit card. So I was like, okay. And the next thing you know, I bought the biggest pack that the company had. I never should have given the card without asking what I was getting, but it looked like it was 3 feet long when it arrived, and I had this huge box of stuff and all these products sitting in my apartment. But I was feeling really good, and people knew I was feeling better than I had in a long time because I was taking products. And my friends would come over and say, my gosh, you look so good, so different. You know, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm taking the stuff that's in this box. Well, how do I get some of that? I said, I have no idea. You'll have to call my daughter, you know? And that's how it started. And then everybody started wanting stuff, and I started sharing products. And I played around with this for 4.5 years. And by playing around with it, what I mean is nothing makes me feel better than to make a difference in somebody's life, nothing. I believe that's why we are here, is to serve others, to make a difference, to give. And so every time I shared a product and somebody's life changed, or they would come to me and say, Lynn, thank you for, you know, you've changed my life, I feel so much better, and they're hugging me and I'm bawling. And all of a sudden I found a purpose, because I knew I wasn't supposed to be selling tile at 50 years old. I knew there was more for me. And all of a sudden, I'm feeling filled with purpose to impact people. But I was doing it by sharing products. I knew it was network marketing. I caught on to that. But I didn't want to be a network marketer, because anytime I mentioned it, people reacted violently. Like, I can't believe you got sucked into one of those. And, you know, this is a cult. And my daughter said, just so you know, don't even mention this to anybody I know. None of my friends would be interested in hearing about any of this. You know, and I'm like, this is cool, it's all right. And so it made me back up. It made me not want to talk about the industry. I thought, okay, it felt a whole lot better when I was helping people with knee pain. You know, I don't like the industry part, the network marketing part. And so I stayed away from even talking about the business. And I was so not wanting to be a network marketer that I would pray nobody would ask me if this was network marketing, because somehow, if I said yes, it was going to devalue the product, and then they weren't going to want to buy it. And then I had to deal with all these issues in my head as I was selling the product of, oh my gosh, the person doesn't have much money, maybe I should just give it to them. I felt like if I was making a profit on the product, there was something wrong with that. There was something wrong with me making money. So I gave a lot away, and then I took care of people. Like I said, 4.5 years into this, I was making probably $400 a week. And I felt like I had died and gone to heaven. I honestly did. But I was still working a full-time job. And, you know, and now I'm in my mid-50s, and I'm working 60 hours a week at a job, but I'm making $400 a week by helping people, and I found my purpose. And so I was happy, but I was tired. And I thought, okay, if I can make $400 a week, maybe I could make more. So I decided to go to a corporate event, my very first one. And I went there because I wanted to see what the people look like who were making all the big money. I'm thinking, I want to see what they look like. I have no education. I mean, I barely got out of high school. And by that, I mean, I didn't even know I was going to graduate till 3 days before. So no education whatsoever. I thought all the people in network marketing who were the success people that you see, you know, when you talk about network marketing, you see on stage, I thought they'd all be men. I thought they'd all be dressed in three-piece suits and alligator shoes, and they're all gonna be rah-rah people, and all the things that don't move my heart at all. But that's who I thought I was gonna see. But I decided to go, my sister came with me, and we went to a convention, and I spent 3 days at this event looking at the top leaders in this company standing on stage sharing their story. And what I realized for the very first time at the event, which is why I'm so passionate about events, what I realized is that these were just ordinary people who had achieved extraordinary things in their lives because they chose this as their vehicle. They were plumbers and housewives and people who had never done it before. The thing they all had in common was that they didn't want the life they had. They wanted more. And when I was listening to the people speaking up there, I thought to myself, if they can do it, I can do it. I can do this. They didn't have educations, not all of them. I mean, they were ordinary people who fought because they wanted more. And at that event, I will never forget it because it was life-changing for me. And I looked at my sister, and after seeing some of the speakers, and I said to her, if they can do it, we can do it. I know we can do this, you know? And I didn't know how to do it. I didn't have a clue how I was gonna do it. I didn't have a Steve Schwartz calling me every day, you know, saying, come on, make a call, make a call, make a call, you know, and beat me up. He does that now sometimes. In fact, when he wants me to do something that I don't really think I want to do, he says, Lynn, are you a founder or a flounder? That's what he says when he wants me to do stuff. So, but you know, I didn't have an upline, right? So I had nobody. But I made a decision. And it was a turning point in my life. I didn't say, how am I going to do it? How am I going to figure out how to do it? What do I need to do? Where am I going to find the people? How do I talk to people? I didn't say any of that. I made a decision. And I drew a line in the sand, and I said, this will be my future. I knew it. I knew it. So as I'm at this convention, I thought, okay, I am going to do this. So I go to Fred Cooper, Dr. Fred Cooper, and I say, Fred, okay, if I'm gonna do this, you know, I wanna make a lot of money because I wanna take my family on trips. I wanna be at the beach, a little scary right now, but that's what I asked for. You know, I want a lot. I want to give a lot. I want to help people. I want to serve. What do I need to do in order to make $250,000 a year? And he said, Lynn, it's really simple. You need to find 4 people who want to make $50,000 a year or more, minimum of $50,000 a year, and you help those four people make $50,000 a year, and you can make $250,000 a year. And I'm like, seriously? That's it? I gotta find four people who wanna make $50,000 a year, and I can make $250,000. And I thought, you know, I live in Florida, Central Florida. There's 18 million people there. I thought, okay, I'm gonna go home, I'll get two from the north, two from the south, whatever. I'm gonna get my four people, and I'm gonna be making $250,000 a year. That's what he told me. Then I went to somebody else there. I went to a top leader at the event. He didn't know me. I just walked up to this guy because I heard him talk. And I said to him, if you can give me two pointers on how to get to where you are, what are they? And I'm giving you my two pointers now because it's what he gave me and it worked. And first one, he said, work on yourself first. That's what he said, work on yourself first. I had no clue what that meant. Nothing, I just wrote it down. Work on yourself first. I thought it's because I was so unhealthy and so fat that he was like, you know, take care of this. I thought that's what he meant by work on yourself first. And the second thing he said was, if you're gonna build this, build it quickly, because it's painful building it slowly. Those are the pointers. So for everybody in the room here, before you leave here today, I would encourage you to get with some of the leaders that are here and ask them to give you two pointers. I just gave you mine, so you all have them. Work on yourself first, and if you're gonna do this, gonna build it quickly, because it's painful to do it slowly. So what I learned at this event was that I was gonna become a network marketer, that I had to find four people in Florida, I thought, I had to find four people, I had to work on myself, and I had to go fast. That's all I knew. I had, like I said, I didn't have a Steve, I didn't have an upline. So I go home and I'm like, oh my gosh, I gotta work on myself. So I go on a diet, because I think that's what work on yourself means. And I start doing that, and then I need four people. And so I went out and I started talking to all these people and vomiting, you know, just like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna make $250,000. And I started telling all these people that I'm looking for people for my team, and they're like, how does it work? And I'm like, I have no idea. You know, I don't even know why I'm getting paid. I didn't know the comp plan. I am not a detail-oriented person. And so when I saw yesterday, when I saw the charts and the numbers, I was like, wow, that is so awesome to break it down, to say this is what you need each week. I have never done that because numbers, it's just not how my brain works. But I was so passionate about what I was doing that people called me ignorance on fire. That's what I was when I came back. All I knew is that I was going to do this. So the very first thing that I did was I started thinking about why. Why am I going to do this? And people have told me my whole life that goals are so important, and if you want something, you just have to write it down, and you'll never accomplish it if you don't write down your goals. And I wrote down goals for years, but nothing ever changed in my life. This time when I came back, I started writing and thinking about, at my core, what would I do with my life if I could have it all? And by all, I mean wake up every day and do exactly what made my heart feel good, with no limitations on time or money. So I started thinking about, okay, Lynn, if you didn't have to worry about time, if you didn't have to go to work, if you didn't have to worry about money, what would you be doing? And I realized that I never ever took the time in my life to think about that, because I was always struggling just to survive. I was taking care of kids, I was taking care of others. You know, I never allowed myself to dream. And I talk to a lot of people when I'm coaching them, a lot of people who join my team. They say to me, Lynn, I don't even know, I've never thought about that. I've never thought about it. I never knew there was any more than what I had. I didn't know network marketing. I went to work, I raised my kids, I came home, you know, watched TV and went to bed, you know, ate some crap food before I went to bed. You know, it didn't matter. I didn't know there was a possibility for somebody like me to have more. So I realized as I was thinking about all this that the most important thing was for me to decide what I wanted. And that is a vision. And that's where I'm going to start for you guys, because here's the three things that were so key. I had to decide, like I said, at my core, not what other people thought I should do, but what I wanted. The first was to create my vision. And I wrote a vision in present tense, because in my mind, it was already done. It was done, because I had made the decision. And so because I made the decision, it was finished. So I just said, okay, I'm gonna be living at the beach, it was a date, it is this date. You know, it felt so wonderful to watch my grandson play ball, and then next week I'm taking my entire family on a cruise, and we're doing this, and we're doing this, and I lived at the beach, I was having a glass of wine on my patio, and I was listening to the seagulls and the ocean, and I created on that piece of paper the life that I now live. I created it. And I think what happens with people is they've forgotten how to dream. They settle. I settled in mediocrity my entire life. My entire life, I settled. And so many people are doing that. And I know that the reason that they don't move forward is what's between their ears. It was what stuck me, it's what sticks everybody, and what happened today was such a wonderful experience for all of you to break through some of that, but I wrote out my life. I said, this is what I am doing. And then I went about looking for my four people, right? So I thought, okay, this is where I'm gonna be in 2 years. I need to find four people, you know, who want to work, who have a dream, who wanna do this. I thought finding four people who would work with me and wanna do it with me and create the life and only have to find four people for $250,000 would be really easy. I thought, piece of cake. But it wasn't. And what I figured out was that so many people, they have a dream and they say they want it, but when it comes to doing what it takes to do it, they don't do it. They don't do it. They want it, they buy into the dream, they pay for the biggest pack. It arrives at their door, you call them to start their training, and you never see them again. Does that happen to anybody here? You know? Martha's like, yep, right there. You know, it's amazing to me, you know, how people are. But the part that is important is I knew that this was the life I was going to have. And once you know, or I knew, where I was going, nothing was gonna stop me. So I didn't care if people said yes or if people said no, because I wasn't attached to the outcome at all. I was just looking for four. And I didn't care how many people I had to talk to find my four, because I wasn't gonna let total strangers who were saying no to me steal my dream. That's it, wasn't gonna let it happen. Because it was mine. And I wanted it, and I claimed it, and I owned it. So I didn't care. I didn't care what they thought. I didn't care what my kids thought about what I was doing. I didn't care what my friends thought about what I was doing. I'm talking to people who are laughing at me, saying, I can't believe you got sucked into that. And I'm like, you know, you're commuting to a dead-end job, you know, working for somebody, and, you know, you're not happy. You know, I'm going after what I want. This is where I'm going. So I created my vision. Number one, I wrote it out and I read it 5 times a day because I was living at the beach and I had this and I had that, everything. And every time it got hard. And it got hard. Every time it got hard, I looked at that piece of paper and I said, Lynn, what will it cost you if you quit? And what was on that paper is what it would cost me if I quit. And I wasn't willing to give it up because I made a decision that that was my life. And I knew without a shadow of a doubt that that's where I was going. So I made the decision with my vision. Then I decided that I was willing to pay the price. And I think that is the most important thing. And I heard it all day yesterday from the leaders that were standing up here talking. I knew it would be a sacrifice. I knew it. Everybody's plate's full. You know, I sat down with my husband, you know, and I'm like, okay, the life that we now know is over temporarily. And I ran it all by him, and I said, because this is the life we will have. 2 years. I wrote it 2 years out. This is where we are going to go. So it means we're not going to be having dinners together every night. It means we're not going to do this and not going to do that. You know, and, you know, so for the next 90 days, you're probably not going to see me much because the other guy told me I had to go fast. So I was like, okay, got to build it fast. So I said, I need to go to work because I have to find four people. You know, so the sacrifice, knowing that you will sacrifice. And the third is just being willing to pay the price that it is. So I don't know if I said them in order, but it was vision, know you're going to sacrifice, and pay the price. Because there's always a price. Because there are things in your life that happen. And you have to decide. And it's kind of like what Simon was saying yesterday, that he was on a picnic. And he's like, you're on a picnic? That's how I was. That's exactly how I was. I was so committed. And my kids are saying to me, you know, is that all you think about? Is that? And I said, pretty much, you know, right now, that's all I think about. And my daughter would say, Mom, you have no balance in your life. You have no balance in your life. All you do is think about this. And I'm like, you don't get it. Balance and momentum are not synonymous. They're not. They are not. If you want to grow and you want to build, you commit and you get it done. And when people say to me, Lynn, this is hard, I'm like, sure it's hard. But what you're doing right now is hard. And you've been working hard for the last 20 years, you're gonna work hard for the next 20. So why not get the hard out of the way and just freaking do it? You know, it's the truth. You know, it's not easy. I've never told anybody that this was easy. It was not easy for me. I made so many mistakes, I didn't know what to say, I did a lot of the wrong things, but it never mattered in the long run because I wrote out my vision and I was going there. So when you commit at that level, let me rephrase that, you will not get to where you want to be if you don't commit at that level. You have to commit at that level. You have to own it. You have to make a conscious choice that you are going to do this with or without anybody. I remember being filled with fear. When I first started, the first few years, I was scared to death because I was embarrassed about network marketing. Once I made my decision, I did not care what anybody thought. But I realized after I made my decision that I had things to work on. And majorly was my belief. You know, there are three things you have to believe if you're gonna build this business. One is in the products, one is in the industry, and one is in yourself. I believed in the products, the industry, I didn't understand it really well, but I committed I was gonna do it because I saw it at an event and I knew that was mine. I felt like I landed right in that spot to hear those people to change my life, for me to be standing up here to hopefully help change yours. It's what it was. And I just forgot what I was saying. I was like, I was just going somewhere really good, and it went out of my head. Believe in the products. So the products were easy. I had to work on believing in the industry. And I did that by studying. I did Tim Sales, Brilliant Compensation, over and over and over. And I thought, oh, that's what this is. We do that every day anyway. You share something, you know, you get a referral, you know. I did that. I did The Perfect Business. That was the other one with Robert Kiyosaki. And I listened to those and listened to those and listened to those, and I realized that this is one powerful, powerful business. And I accepted the business model. I got out of the personal stuff that said every time anybody says no to me, I'm devastated and cut off at the knees, and it brings up every issue of my childhood, and I'm rejected, and I'm afraid to talk to anybody. It was gone, because I understood the business model, and this was going to create freedom in my life. Then it came to belief in myself, and that's where I struggled. I knew I was going to do it, but the belief in myself, because I had self-worth issues, because I never had anything in my life. I never did anything in my life. And so when I first started, I was going after the wrong people because I had self-worth issues. Even though I was looking for my four, I was going to people I had influence over instead of looking for people of influence. I was looking in the wrong spot because I didn't want to be rejected and because I didn't think highly enough of myself. You know, so I had to work on that. I worked really hard on that and, you know, changing my mindset, changing my beliefs, and I still work on that. We're all works in progress. It doesn't happen overnight. But those are the beliefs that I had to get past in order to do this. And, you know, I just want to encourage everybody that's in here. I mean, you just had a powerful event today. It was powerful yesterday. You took your time to be here. You came out, you know, showing up. And the leadership that's in this room is so amazing. And it tells me that you want it. And you wouldn't be here if you didn't want it. And I'm just really proud of everybody in this room for showing up, for taking your notes, you know, for learning. And, you know, you're going to come out of here different people. And something that somebody said is going to impact you. One little thing, one little nugget that you get from somebody can change everything. So for me, those are the three things that I did. Then I decided I was gonna go find my people. So I wrote something down because I missed things I was gonna say the other day. So I just wanna make sure that I'm on this. All right, so once I got past looking for the wrong people and realized who I really was gonna look for, once I did my personal growth, who I was gonna talk to, I went in a totally different direction. And I've listened to everybody's stories of how they build, and I do it pretty much differently. I lead with the business because I led with the product for 4.5 years. The whole time I led with the product. When I shifted to lead with the business, within 6 months I was making like 10 times the amount I was making when I led with the product. And the reason I started leading with the business, it wasn't because I wanted to be a network marketer. It's because I realized that if you love your products and you want to change the world and you want to get them into the hands of people, you know, who are getting wiped out with statin drugs and all that stuff, you know, and you want to educate people, you can't do it one person at a time. I was talking to somebody, I'm like, yeah, I helped you. And I thought, oh my gosh, I need an army of me. And that's how I approached it. I went to people and I just said, you know, I'm putting a power team together. I'm looking for a few select people. And, you know, the products are amazing, you know, and I need help. I need help. Because I looked at it entirely different. I thought if each one of us had four people, who could help four people, who could help four people, the products will get out there, the world will change, you know, health will change. People's finances would change if everybody did just that. And so I decided I was gonna lead with the business. And it started that way in 2002, and I've never changed. I've always said the same thing. If I'm looking for people, if I'm out recruiting or looking for people, I always have said the same thing. Bob, do you keep your options open to making money outside of blank? All right, whatever you do. If I go to, I'm at Dillard's, I'm at the makeup counter, and I meet somebody that's outgoing and has an incredible personality and takes really good care of me, and I'm thinking, wow, that would be an awesome person to work with. You know, I'm gonna say Mary, oh, that was Bob before, now it's Mary. Mary, let me ask you, you know, do you keep your options open to making money outside of working here at Dillard's? And she's like, what, are you kidding? Of course I do. I mean, who says no to that? Nobody says no when I say that. And I said, you know what? I would love to work with somebody like you. Thank you so much for the great service. You really went above and beyond and take care of me. You are somebody that I would consider, you know, for my power team. I'm looking to expand my business. It may be for you or it may not. Either way is fine. But I'd love to get your information. And let's sit down and we'll explore the possibilities. And, you know, the lady is in her purse giving me everything but her blood type. You know, everybody says yes to that. Do you keep your options open to making money outside of what whatever? Everybody says yes. So that's, when I meet with the business, that's always what I say. And it's really interesting because people on my team, they say, Lynn, you know, I don't have enough people, you know, I don't know what to say, and so I just teach them to say that. And this is, I guess this is my boot camp thing, because most people would never do this, but I was doing a training in one time, and there was a whole lot of people in the room, and I said, how many people feel like they don't have enough people to talk to? Of course, everybody's hands up. How many people will do whatever it takes to get more people to talk to? Everybody's hands up. You know, okay, I have an idea. So I have a button. I have this button's name. And the button says, I'm looking for three good people. That's it. I said, who in the room would wear this button and just walk through the mall and just go wherever you go wearing a button that says, I'm looking for three good people? And of all the hands that were up in the air, 98% of them went down. I'm like, oh, and somebody said, I wear a button. You know, and I send people out, you know, just when you're not in your job, just put on a button. I'm looking for three good people. And people walk up to you and they say, I'm a good person. What are you looking for? You know, it was just a recruiting thing. All I knew is I needed to get four people. So I was really, really creative in different things that I did, because nobody was going to come knocking at my door. You know, I didn't know people that had money. Everybody I knew was broke like me. You know, everybody that I knew hated network marketing. So it was about getting creative and going out there, because I was looking for my four. So I lead with the business. I have from the start. But I love preferred customers, because customers are the foundation of our business. Reps come in and, you know, they work for 2 months and they don't make any money, and they're like, oh my gosh, this is just another one of those pyramid things. Network marketing doesn't work. I'm done. You know, even if they love the product, doesn't matter. They don't make any money, they quit. Customers, they come in with no expectation except to take healthy products. And so for me, in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, a strong customer base is really, really important. Because if every one of my reps quit, my income would settle to the depth of my customer base. I figured that out really fast. So I wanted customers and business partners. And I keep them totally separate, and I still do today. I separate them. If somebody says to me, you know, I have diabetes or I have arthritis and I'm not feeling good, I don't talk to them about business. You know, I talk to them about health. But if I'm looking for business partners, they know that I'm looking for business partners, because that's what I tell them. In the beginning, I would try to sneak it in and drop a hint and, you know, like, yeah, I'm doing something really cool where you can make a lot of money, you know, and they wouldn't react, so I thought, well, they're not interested. I was so embarrassed, but I am now, when people say to me, what do? I say, I'm a professional network marketer. That's what I am. I am a professional network marketer, and I've never been more proud of anything than to be a part of RX and to own the fact that network marketing is what set me free. It doesn't get any better than this. So for my customers, this is how I do it, because I want the residual, I want the leverage. And so when somebody says to me, okay, Jill says, okay, Lynn, I want to be your, you know, I want to get on the products. This is my conversation. Okay, well, that's great. What I want you to do, though, is commit that you're going to take the products for a minimum of 90 days, because your body didn't get this way overnight. And I'm shaking my head, and they're shaking their head. Okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set you up so the products are automatically delivered right to your door every 28 days. You don't have to go out and get them. I know you're busy. You don't have to worry about running out. They're going to come right to you. And for that, you're going to get an extra 30% off. And they're like, thank you. I don't say, would you like to order 1 month? Would you like to go on auto delivery? You know, do you want your credit card charged every month? That's what I say. 90 days. I want you to commit for 90 days. Your body didn't get this way overnight. All right, did everybody get that? Or should I do it again? Got it? Okay. That's how I get customers to commit to be on auto delivery. The other thing that I do is I do a little health assessment when a new customer starts with me. I'm like, okay, let's look at where you are now. I say, tell me how you're feeling. Well, I don't sleep, my knee hurts, this is going on, I have back pain, and they tell me all the things that are wrong with them. And I have them write it all down. Everything, we date it, we write it on a piece of paper, and we just fold it up and we put it in an envelope. And the reason I do that is because when you're taking, you know, Vinali and the Optimal, you have to be taking all that, you don't have immediate, like, ta-da, you know, and after a couple months, people are thinking, why am I spending this money? Because I don't feel any different. And the changes are subtle. And so when the 90 days comes to an end, and they're like, Lynn, I want to go off my auto ship, I don't think I can afford it, you know, that's when I look at their thing, and I say, how's your back feeling? Oh, now that you mention it, yeah, my back's been doing pretty good. You know, how are you sleeping? How's this? How's that? And all of a sudden, it dawns on them that the products are making a difference in their life. And that's what keeps them going. And so that's what I've always done to get preferred customers on AutoShip. You know, so the other thing is that's how I manage their expectations, because I think with business partners, when you're bringing in a new team member or a new preferred customer, it is really, really important to manage their expectations. So I say, you know, you didn't get this way overnight, you know? So they know that they need to take this long term. They don't expect to feel something, you know, right away. So to me, that is why I have a good base of customers. So does that help?
Yeah.
Okay, so. Okay, so that's the customers, manage expectations. That's it, that's my whole first page. Okay. All right, so when I start somebody, I'm gonna talk about this because I wrote this in order so that I wouldn't forget any of this. When I bring somebody into the business, the first thing I have them do is their vision statement. I think we all got that. I will not work with somebody if they don't write a vision statement. If they write it and send it to me and it sounds like, I want to make money, I want to be debt free, I'm gonna write them back and say, this is not about what you want, this is about what you already have. I want you to rewrite this in present tense. I don't want a list, I want an emotional connection to why you're doing this, because if you're not emotionally connected and all in, you're not gonna do it, you're not. All right, so that's the first thing they do. The second thing is the boss, all right? The boss, we talked about it yesterday, it's incredible. I spent so much time before the boss training people saying, you gotta look at this and send this video, do this, do this, and do this. The boss has everything. I don't spend my time teaching people what they can go online and get themselves, because I'm about income producing activities, because this is business and it's their business. If they join, it's their business. So I have a responsibility to them, but I'm not responsible for them. I'm gonna make sure they're trained, I'm gonna make sure I give them the material, I'm gonna make sure they know exactly what to do. And we all know that a lot of people are not gonna do it. And I had to get past the point, when I'm talking about my personal growth, I had to get past the point where I felt responsible for that. In the beginning, I was like, oh my gosh, I signed up these people, they're not making any money, I feel so bad, and you know, and I'd be sending them reminder after reminder, there's a training on Saturday, I'm texting, I'm emailing, I'm calling, you know, and I have team members that do that now, and I'm like, you guys, why are you reminding somebody that 9 times that there's a training on Saturday? You know there was a training on Saturday. You know, I don't do that anymore. I put the date, I say here it is, I give them a heads up, there it is. They either show up or they don't show up, but that's on them. My job is to make sure that they know. So I have them do the boss. Then I have them make a list. And the way I do it is I have people make a list of 50 people who they think, you know, come to their mind right away that might be people they would want to work with. Doesn't matter whether they're gonna do it or not, it's just who they might want to work with. That's that, and then I have them write down 25 people who they would choose as customers. And these are people that already supplement, these are people that have health challenges, these are people that, you know, are open and maybe aren't thrilled with all the medications they're taking and they've got things going on, I just say, write down. People who want to lose weight, give me that list as well. Now, when somebody does their list and has 50 people, my next conversation is really, really important. It is to go over that list with them because I don't know the people. They know the people. And people receive information differently. Some people, they get really excited about coming to an in-home meeting. Some people do really good with crowds. They get caught up in the energy. They love it. It feels just so awesome. So when I go over the list with the people, I want them to identify on that list who would do good in an in-home, or it can be a Zoom, whatever. I call it IH for in-home. Who would be better with a one-on-one, and who wouldn't take the time for either that just maybe wanted you to email on something. So we go down the list, and they're like, well, Mary loves to be invited to something. I said, okay, you know, she's an in-home. This one's a one-on-one. You know, this and that's, and you know, they give me the reasons why, and we categorize all the people that are on this list because not everybody receives information the same way. They don't want it the same way. Some people, they just want you to sit down and take the time to be with them. They don't want to be part of the crowd. Other people, they don't want to be singled out when you're sitting down because they feel pressured by that. They want to blend in with the crowd. So I always break down the list with the people. Really important so that we know who we're talking to. And once we do that, my next step with a new person is a business plan. So many people, they go out there trying to build this business, and you know, they're talking and blowing off all of their best prospects because they don't know what to say, because it's like building a house, you know, and they're starting with the roof. And so the business plan is key. And that is about, I have their vision statement, I know what they want. The business plan is about finding their avatar. Where is their passion? They are joining RX. Why? Their passion is weight loss. Their passion is making a difference in the world to give everybody clean water. Their passion is getting wrinkles off of people's faces. Their passion is the business. Finding their avatar. It is key. If you're looking and you know, for me, okay, it was business. And so if a person says to me, what I want to do is I want to lead with the business. You know, I'm passionate about it all. I'm passionate about network marketing. I want to find other people passionate about network marketing. The business plan helps because you have to know where to find those people. They're not going to come knocking at your door. So you've got to know what to do to find them. And that's where I was when I started and decided I was going to do that. I'm like, I don't know any network marketers. You know, I got to find four people. I don't know any of them. Where would they be? And I'm thinking, okay, I want people that are working on personal growth. I want people who are entrepreneurial. So I started looking up meetings and things where people went. You know, BNI is one. I went to my first BNI meeting. I was so scared because I had to get up for 30 seconds and say something. I'm telling you, I got peed my pants just doing it, but I did it. I got up and I said what I did, and that one business meeting that I went to, I met Rick Billings, who has been on my team for years and years and years. He was a photographer. He was a photographer there doing his thing, I was doing my thing. I met him because I went to a BNI meeting. I went to lots of different events. I searched people in personal development. You know, you've got to find your avatar. When I was really focused on SlenderX and I wanted to find the SlenderX market, I'm like, okay. I mean, we see a million pictures on Facebook of here's my before and after, and everybody's marketing like that, and I know it's good. In my brain, I'm thinking, okay, where do people who want to lose weight hang out? I'm thinking, okay, Weight Watchers. So I had some flyers made, and I sent somebody over to a Weight Watcher meeting and put flyers on all the car and Weight Watchers. And, you know, I was thinking of where are people? They're in the gym. They would be at Weight Watchers. They would be, you know, maybe walking. I actually started a meetup group. I thought, I want older women, baby boomer women, who want to lose weight, who want to be healthy. How do I find them? So I started a meetup group, which I'd never done before, and all I looked for was people who wanted to walk on the beach at 9 in the morning, 2 days a week. I said, I want people who are, you know, 45 and older, ladies, no little kids, people who wanted to walk on the beach. Because I figured if they want to walk on the beach, it means they love the beach, so we have something in common. It means they want to walk, which means they're into fitness, which means some of them are probably too fat. You know, so I just did this whole logical thing in my head. And I started a meetup, and I had, I think, 12 ladies within the first day message me and said, okay, see you there. And it was really interesting because two of the ladies were network marketers who were trying to recruit me. They came because they saw the meetup, and they were looking to get me. And one of them was a chiropractor that came. And so I thought, okay, that's good, you know, for the weight loss. So it's about being creative. How are you going to find the people in your avatar? Where are they? I work really hard on identifying, you know, just crazy ideas, and there's no right or wrong, but you gotta do things. I remember, I can't believe I'm sharing this, I remember my mom liked to gamble. When my mom was alive, she liked to play the slots. And there where she lived, she had a cruise ship that went out. And it would go like 3 miles offshore, and I would go down there and I would take her out on the cruise ship so she could play the slots and would come back. And she was in her 80s, and she would have the time of her life. And I'm thinking, okay, I'm looking for risk takers, people who have time in their hands, people with disposable money, you know, all that kind of stuff. The people on the cruise ship would be really good. So I had these little cards printed, you know, just little paper things that said, call me if you want to fire your boss or something. And anyway, I had some things on the cars in the parking lot, and then I gave my mom these little cards, and we boarded really early, and I would take her to a section of the slot machines where there was nobody around, and I'd give her stack and say, just walk up and down and put one in every tray, you know, of the slot machines, because somebody would pick it up, you know, and it would mean they might want to do business, you know, and they would call. And so what I did is I had a toll-free number on there. It wasn't me they were calling. I recorded a message. And I don't remember exactly what it said, but it said something like, you know, being part of the next trillion-dollar industry, you know, looking for people, you know, who entrepreneurial in spirit, looking for, you know, their plan B. And it said, you know, a lot of people say they're looking, but they're just window shopping. So on a scale of 1 to 10, if your interest level is 5 or less, please hang up now. I remember that. And then if you're a 6 or a 7, email, and 9 or 10, you know, leave your numbers, speak clearly at the beep, and I'll call you. And we had people call, no matter when we did it, no matter where we put these cards, we took, and they weren't cards, it was an 8.5 by 11 sheet in fuchsia, because it stands out, and then you cut it in nine squares, nine of them went to a page. It was fuchsia. I had my husband go around and put them on every bulletin board anywhere. You know how you go to the grocery store and there's 9,000 cards, and there's 9,000, everywhere you go, people stick cards up, but nobody sees them. But I had a fuchsia, big thing. I just had them stick it right in the middle. So people would take my card, my paper, because it was bright colored. I mean, it's just craziness. But find your avatar, that's the key. You've gotta go after your market. And be creative, and make sure that you're not all over the place. Because so many people, they're like, well, if they don't like the Nutri-Fi, you know, how about a water bottle? Well, you could stand to lose a few. How about some Slenderex? Or what about your wrinkles? You know, people are all over the place, and I think it's really important that you have laser focus on your passion, because your passion is what's going to sell the people. That's what's going to make them want to join you. So that takes care of that page. Look at me. I have no idea how long I've been talking, but I'm almost done. Are we good?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's how, you know, those are the key things that are important to me or for you, is make a decision. Not everybody wants a six-figure income from this. Not everybody is looking for what I was looking for, but you've got to know what you're looking for. And that's the key. And that's why, as leaders in this room, you've got to understand what your people are looking for, because you can't lead them if you don't know where they want to go. And bottom line, you have to know what they're fighting for. Because when they're having a bad day, you're going to say, what about that beach house? What happened to that? Because that's how I am. When people complain to me now, I'm in their face. I'm like, what about that? What are you talking about? Well, people said no today. I just had the worst day. I said, well, just go chill out, have a glass of wine, and start over tomorrow. You know, it's like that. You don't get all caught up in that. Because, you know, this is not a race. And I want people to understand that and not to compare yourself to other people. Because it's different for everybody. And if it takes you 2 years or 5 years or 10 years to get to a place where you're making 50 grand a year in residual income, what else you got working for you right now that's going to do that? Nothing. So don't beat yourself up if you're not going at the same pace of other people. That's really, really important. Okay, you know it's a numbers game. You got to get rid of your stinking thinking. The other part of this is, we talked about it yesterday, or several people talked about it.